Alright, yo, what up people on the WeedTube and YouTube, if this is on the YouTube. But basically, I'm doing a quick little sesh here. I'm gonna talk about some movies and shit that are great to watch while you're a stoner. And one thing that I'm gonna start off with is... Oh shit, let me move this.
Okay.
Yo, sorry about that. One cool thing is this new documentary on Netflix called Jim and Andy. And it's actually about Jim Carrey, who I didn't used to think was that dope. Like, I loved his movies as a kid, but I didn't think it was very mature or anything. Obviously, other than The Truman Show and Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. So, this documentary came out with really old footage, and he's with, like, Danny DeVito and shit, where he plays this guy, Andy Kaufman. Now, Andy Kaufman was a real-life comedian. He was basically, like, right now's fucking, oh my god. What's the name of that guy? The Eric Andre of back then. So he would just go around trolling everybody. He'd go on like Letterman and big stuff like that. And he would just fuck around and get everybody pissed off at him, basically. And this was a real life guy. And Jim Carrey kind of got his foot into the door with acting and everything by playing the role of this guy in a movie called Man on the Moon back then. And just now the footage has finally been released, like 30 years after. And Jim Carrey talks about like playing a role, disappearing into the role of another person, like losing who you yourself is and not understanding like the boundaries of all. I don't know, it's so fucking interesting. Gets really deep into acting and like playing other roles and stuff like that. Holy shit, that movie is great. And I didn't think much of Jim Carrey until I saw that, but like he's actually dope. He talks about like Carl Jung or Jung, and then like Alan Watts and a lot of this like trippy type shit with Terrence McKenna and psychedelic type thinking, and I don't know. Jim Carrey's dope. But I'm gonna take another rip here. I'm gonna set a timer for 20 minutes so I don't forget about filming. Wait, what was that? Someone commented, bro, what would you change your enemies into if you could? Wait, was that the question? Or I don't know what that said. If I could change an enemy into something, I'd change him into like a fucking snake or something. I'm also gonna roll up a blunt during the process of this, so, you know, let's just go right off the top of my head. I think I have some lists some places, but this video wasn't planned out. This is a video that I've wanted to do for fucking, like, ever, but I think I always built it up too much. I wanted it too edited, too, like, polished off, where I realized I should just literally, like, chill and talk about movies I like, because that's kind of, like, the whole point of it. Change them into mosquitoes. No one likes mosquitoes. Also, they would get hit real fucking quick. And you wouldn't even be the one doing it. So changing an enemy into a mosquito is a good plan because then you don't actually have to be doing any of the harming. So that's smart. Change them to a blunt and then smoke them. Yeah, I mean, that's a way to do it. So we like raw videos? Well, I'm so fucking glad to hear that, Mel. Everybody, mellow water, yeah, that's dope. I'm glad that you said that. I'm glad that people are feeling that way, because I love doing the raw videos as well. And you know, honestly, like, I'm not even gonna talk about that. Basically, though, at this point, I don't even want to edit, like, me talking. Like, I literally don't enjoy it. I like editing either, like, B-roll footage that I took, of just, like, B-roll, you know, or I like putting up uncut videos like this. I don't like doing a video where it's about talking, and then I have to cut that. I literally don't even want to do that. So that might sound really weird because that's kind of like most of YouTube, but I've just kind of found out that like if I'm gonna spend any time editing, I want it to be like the Puerto Rico video, like a B-roll type shit against music. Yo, bro, what would you recommend eating for gnarly farts? You mean like, do you want gnarly farts or do you want to like fix the problem? Because if you want gnarly ones, Taco Bell, lots of carbohydrates and lots of fiber. I don't know why someone brought that up. I don't know why we're fucking talking about that now. But let's go off the top of my head for a movie that I would love to recommend. Now, I'm not going to be talking about like stoner movies like Super Troopers or Pineapple Express because I fucking love those movies, but I would assume that most of us know about them and have already watched them. So I'm going to be talking about some movies that I've enjoyed that maybe people probably haven't heard about, but are definitely a mindfuck and really, really enhanced by smoking during the movie. So, perfect example right now I'm going to start off with is a director. His name is Satoshi Kon. So Satoshi Kon is fucking dank. Satoshi Kon is one of the most masterful editors of all fucking time, and all of his movies have to pertain with the perception of time and space and just society and living in the modern world. It's so wild, and a perfect example of a movie that he did was Paprika. So Paprika is kind of, it's almost like an Inception-like plot, and like, by the way, this came out way before Inception, like 7 years before, I think. I think it's a 2004 movie. Inception was 2011. I'll have to triple check that, but Paprika is about entering into dreams, and that's all I'm gonna say about it. All this type of shit is so up to interpretation, and every time I watch this movie, it blows my fucking mind, and I have a completely different take and conclusion from it. But basically, it delves really deep into how we perceive time, and then, like, it'll do the craziest editing that you've never seen before, and, like, okay, that's all I gotta say. Paprika, you have to see. It's really fun, it's really trippy, it's mind-blowing, there's intense moments, there's super fun, adorable moments, and overall, it's a very mature plot. There's no, like, stupid cliches or anything during it, and that's why I love it. It is anime, and for people that say, like, oh, I don't watch anime, neither do I, bro. This shit is, like, the best thing ever. Don't let animation turn you off or, you know, the Japanese language. Like, put on those subtitles. Don't complain. It's the best shit ever. Watch Paprika. Okay, I got really into that one. Another movie from that director, the only other movie I've seen from that director, Satoshi Kon, is Perfect Blue. So Perfect Blue is really dark, so I wouldn't recommend it to everybody, but if you want to watch a really in-depth movie about, like, you know, self-identity and actors and how they kind of get lost in their own worlds and, like, basically being sure that you don't get caught up in all of that, it's really interesting. This movie came out about 20 years, I think it's like 1998 or something, or 1997, and it's more relevant than ever. They didn't even have the technology that we have now, and basically the whole movie is about like social media and people creating a fake separate persona and then getting lost with who they even are themselves. Perfect Blue is great. I recommend if you want to actually get deep into that stuff, watch this movie, because that's the thing, like, with a lot of Hollywood movies, they go safe, not even in the sense of, like, violence and stuff, but they never really kind of try to go deep with it or, like, explore something too far. So when you watch Perfect Blue, you literally experience, like, a mental breakdown. I've never seen editing like this, where you're, like, watching it and you literally start feeling like the character and, like, you're losing your mind. I'm probably not making a great point for this movie, but I just gotta say, it's the most intense editing I've seen. I've never felt this much from a movie. And like 5 days later, I was just like, fuck, like still thinking about that. And it's definitely great. Like something that makes you think is what's up. I compare it to like a Hollywood Marvel movie is like a fucking McDonald's, and watching a great cinema, like actual film is like eating a steak. Or Deb, if you're still in here, it's like even, what's the best vegan thing? Like a guacamole bagel with capers on it. I don't know. That might be the equivalent. Do I have a lighter? I feel like I just lit something. Did I not just? Okay, yeah. Well, the blunt is now ready, so let's move on into the next. Another one that I've been thinking about a lot recently, for some reason, is Moonlight. So, oh, I definitely got some weed in my throat from that. So Moonlight is, I'm definitely going to be cautious and tell you guys that it's not going to be a great feel-good movie. It's really intense, and don't expect to see much happen. So Moonlight is what I love because it's like a slice of life kind of movie. And it's basically if Boyhood was like stepped up in like more real and more brutal. And then that's kind of what it's like. And I don't know how to explain why I love this movie so much. It's literally just about a kid. It's like his childhood, his teenagerhood, and then like his adulthood. And that's the whole movie. But like they just do it so fucking well that it feels so real. And you can just see, and then there's just so many lessons of life packed in there. And just so much like in the end, he looks all big and bad and everyone thinks he's all like whatever masculine. But on the inside, they're actually just really sensitive and they just never were able to express that throughout the whole time. And like, oh, it's so fucking cool. I love Moonlight so much. And the reason why I say that is because it came out 2016. And like I don't like talking about this because that makes me sound really pretentious, but there's definitely a difference between like a true film and like just a movie or like a flick, you know? And Moonlight was definitely a dank ass, like real ass movie. And it was everything that I loved about movies. Just pure cinematography. They go rich into the sound design and they just let things flow. Like they don't cut too fast. They don't like have unrealistic scenes. That's the thing with movies, like 99% of goddamn movies aren't anything like real life. How come 99%? Okay, maybe like a 40% or like a 60%, but how come every single time you watch a movie, no matter what, it's not even anything like your actual real life? Like there's always got to be some fucking crazy action or something like that, but in this movie it was just actually like real life. And it was anyways, if I don't be careful, I'm gonna spend like an hour talking about each movie individually. But I mean, I didn't even look at the list, and when I thought of movies to watch while smoking, those came up, so definitely my top recommendations. Have to check out Moonlight, you have to check out Satoshi Kon, watch Perfect Blue, don't watch Perfect Blue, watch Paprika, if you like Paprika, watch Perfect Blue. Now I'm gonna find one of my lists, because I have a lot of lists of, like, movies and shit. I think. I mean, the problem is I make them, but then I delete them. And actually, oh, here's a movies to watch list, but the problem is I haven't seen those ones, so I can't comment much about it, but I can go to that same list and watch the ones I checked off. Kings of Summer, so totally different vibe here, but maybe I should have started with this. Kings of Summer will be great for definitely my audience base. It's like the teenager summer feel good like coming of age flick. And it's so modern. There's fucking Nick Offerman in it, Ron Swanson. There's like just a lot of random awesome cameos. All I gotta say is that it's like coming of age, Kings of Summer, Perks of Being a Wallflower, Almost Famous. What was another one I liked? Juno. I could come up with more, but coming of age is definitely one of my favorite categories. I fucking loved those movies because I watched so many movies as a kid, and just like I literally feel like I like the way I do things in life and like how just like everything I literally like learned all this stuff from movies, because there's so much information packed in, and you don't know what you're watching when you're watching a movie. That might be something that happened to the director. It might be something that haunted them throughout their entire life until they decided to express it through a different form, and like you never know, you know? And like it's so fucking cool. So you just learn so many lessons and mistakes from the directors or the actors or whoever are involved in it. And just like, oh god, fucking love movies so much, man. Gone Baby Gone, that's a good mystery movie. If you want a little whodunit, like little mystery, watch Gone Baby Gone. I'm pretty sure that was Ben Affleck's directorial debut. That was his first movie he directed. His little brother Casey Affleck was in that. Super Boston. I fucking love the whole Boston thing. It had that old guy, he was also in Truman Show, Ed Harris. It also has Ed Harris in that shit. So good. Watch Gone Baby Gone for a mystery. Okay, I'll skip those two. Bottle Rocket. Okay. Fucking Bottle Rocket is so good. This is exactly what I kind of wanted to have the list for. Is movies like this where I know you guys will love it. It's such a stoner movie, but it was so small that nobody's really like heard of it, you know? And then the guy talking about shit earlier is still fucking talking about shit this whole time. but Yeah, okay. So Bottle Rocket is Wes Anderson's directorial debut. He made this little shitty black and white short, and it was like a funny 10-minute video with Owen Wilson and what's the other Wilson? Oh fuck. Right now, blanking on it. The other Wilson's in it as well. But they're both in that, and it's so funny. It's basically these really incompetent people who keep trying to like rob banks and shit, but they like suck. And they're just like they just like, I don't know, it's hilarious. It's a super low budget version of Wes Anderson and has so much heart to it, and it's so like, yeah, that's all I gotta say. So much heart to it, real ass comedy. So Bottle Rocket, 2001 A Space Odyssey, if you haven't seen it and you're into the like, you know, history of cinema, the classic shit, watch 2001 A Space Odyssey. I know it can get real slow at times, and it's definitely not for everybody. So that's what I gotta say. It was made all the way back in like 1968, which is like 50 fucking years ago. So long. And yeah, so if you're into film stuff, you will love this. You'll be like, holy fuck. Like literally all of sci-fi and all of these movies I've seen for the past 50 years, they took so much inspiration from this, and that's how they went forward with it. And Kubrick is a boss, and they're talking about artificial intelligence this long ago and this accurate, and what the fuck? Anyways, not for everybody. Shawshank Redemption, this was one that, like, I was the kind of person that I watched so many, like, true movies that I didn't even want to watch Shawshank. I was like, oh, it's overrated. But I finally watched it this year, and Shawshank is a guaranteed fucking amazing hit. No matter who you're with, no matter what, if you want to have an intense, emotional time with a full story, experience Shawshank. Shawshank is amazing. Put Star Wars, the original one, because again, like, I actually watched the reboot of Star Wars before watching the first ones. I know, some people give me shit, some people be like, what the fuck, who cares? But like, yeah, Star Wars is incredible. Like, the OG A New Hope done really fucking well, and like, goddamn, dude, the movie is great. Eddie the Eagle is a great feel-good movie. That's all I gotta say. It's not exceptional, but it's a movie I've enjoyed in the past few years. I don't feel at home in this world anymore. Now, okay, again, this is one I love mentioning because it sounds like a movie that you're like, what the fuck, why would I want to watch that? I don't feel at home in this world anymore. It's actually a comedy and has no, it's a complete comedy, and it is a dark comedy, but it's fucking hilarious. So, you know when you're just like mad at the world and people are like cutting you off and you're watching people like cut people in line and stuff like that. That's how this movie starts. And it's basically like a super realistic movie. If someone was like, I'm gonna do something about it. And then they're just like, oh shit, I guess I can't do anything about it. And Elijah Wood's in it as some weird guy that has nunchucks and thinks he's a badass. Highly recommend fucking I Don't Feel at Home in This World Anymore. Netflix original. Again, I mean, I feel like a lot of Netflix originals, I could just go on with only Netflix originals, but that's one that I've enjoyed. Also, since we're at it with Netflix, I'd say Altered Carbon. New series that came out, total sci-fi, so fucking enjoyable. I've never enjoyed sci-fi that much before because they made it real gritty and like, it's if you took Blade Runner and then you just like added like modern grit, like, I don't give a fuck kind of person to it. It's so dope. Because that's all I got to say about it. It's literally, like, it's so good. If you like Blade Runner, that. So, yeah. And then, Stand By Me. Oh! Stand By Me is fantastic. I also watched Goonies, which I'm not going to shit on Goonies. I know everybody loves Goonies, but I watched Goonies and I was like, eh. And then I watched Stand By Me and I was like, okay, that's what I was looking for. Oh my god. I just love this movie. And that's one thing I noticed right away. It was PG, so I was expecting it to be really shitty, but that was before the MPAA stepped in and kind of like tightened up everything. So it's a kid's movie, but it's so real, and they don't go unnecessary with any of the cruel jokes or anything. Like, it's so, like, actual kids, and they're, like, actually coming of age during the movie, and they're so realistic. Like, I fucking hate so many kids' movies, and that's why there's a stigma against kids' movies, because they get lazy with it. It's not because it's made for kids, it's because they're like, oh, who cares, it's made for kids, we'll get fucking lazy, and we'll just, like, slap some plots together. You can make a goddamn great kids' movie. Look at Moonrise Kingdom. Oh, also, yeah, okay, that's not even on here, but Moonrise Kingdom, if you haven't watched it, you have to watch it. I like it. No, like, I'm serious about the Moonrise Kingdom, though. I went to the theaters with that when I was about, I guess, 13, because it was 2013, and I went with my dad and my mom. I didn't want to watch the movie. I was just like, it's just a dumb kids movie. And then I just had the most amazing theater experience, probably the best one I've ever had, ever. And I was just like, wow, I was just so fucking blown away. I didn't know about Wes Anderson yet, and I didn't know what I was walking into. And I mean, like, I looked into cinematography a lot before I even watched that, but that was the first movie that I was blown away, like, holy fuck, how did this guy shoot this? Like, I'm, like, overwhelmed with it. Also, you know, I thought this was gonna be like a quick little uncut, but I'm having too much fun. I'm gonna restart the camera here. Set timer for 25 minutes. Wow. I don't know. I'm totally going off here, but I'm having so much fun. I feel like no, I shouldn't have written more down, because then I would have had way too much shit to look at. The Departed, if you haven't seen this, The Departed is probably my favorite, like, if you want to watch, like, action. But it's not action in the sense that it normally is. It's just, like, it's really well written, so you're watching all of these different sides and double agents and people double-crossing each other, and you know who's against who, but they don't know that the person against them is in the same room as them. Oh, shit, and it's that kind of movie. So I love The Departed. Oh, I put some Christmas ones in here. Elf, Jingle All the Way, and Die Hard. Just if you haven't seen them, you should definitely watch. Now, let's see here. Oh, shit. Man, wow. Okay. You know, I went through pretty good on here. There's Rushmore, which is also another Wes Anderson movie that is so good. That's one that's pretty lesser known, but it's Jason Schwartzman's first time acting. So, you know, the guy that has, like, the mustache, and he's just, like, really chill in all the Wes Anderson movies? He was 15 years old in Rushmore. 15 goddamn years old, and he was doing this Wes Anderson movie, and Bill Murray was, like, his teacher person, principal person, and the dynamic of that was great. He's obviously having a great, I don't know what, I'm definitely not watching this. Oh, yeah, I'm definitely not looking at that. I'm getting really fucking into this. But that is the thing, I rattled off a lot, and, like, I didn't have a written list, so I can definitely keep going off the top of my head, but I'm gonna have to, Scott Pilgrim, fucking, oh my god, Edgar Wright all the way. So, you know, people love Edgar Wright's stuff, and I do too. But, like, that's the thing, when I hear Edgar Wright, normally they're talking about the Cornetto trilogy, which is The World's End, Shaun of the Dead, and Hot Fuzz. Obviously not in that order, but those are great movies. I love those movies. I loved Hot Fuzz as a kid. The World's End was done really well, and yeah, Shaun of the Dead's great. But Edgar Wright keeps going further. On his newer stuff, he has fucking Scott Pilgrim versus the World. Honestly, as a teenager, or, like, not a teenager, like, as a pre-teenager, Michael Cera was my shit. I would watch Arrested Development, fucking Juno, that Scott Pilgrim. Did I run out of Michael Cera things? I've watched a lot more than that. Also, there's a Michael Cera movie called, oh shit, okay, wait, I'm gonna really have to dig for this. This was a Sundance movie back in, like, 2010. Michael Cera in The Magical Cactus. Oh, okay, wait, I'm gonna have to search for this. Michael Cera was in this movie where he went on a search through Mexico to find a magical psychedelic cactus and trip balls on it. So, Michael Cera cactus. Oh, I fucking love that movie. Crystal Fairy and the Magical Cactus. That's a great movie. Actually, it's not that great. I just loved it because it was, like, so ridiculous. No, I do like that movie. I'm gonna have to go back and watch it, but I find it really relatable. Just like the wandering around, just like, let's find some fucking psychedelic shit, bro. Like, it's, that's a great movie. So I rattled those off, but also another new Edgar Wright movie that's great is Baby Driver. If you haven't seen Baby Driver, it's a super fun new heist movie. I like how I'm pitching these movies. I'm like, fuck it. But like, seriously, and the problem is, you know, Kevin Spacey's in it, so obviously that's a lot weirder now going back, because that's the problem. I fucking love Kevin Spacey movies, and I don't have to like the guy's piece of shit, but like, he's a great actor, and he has done really fucking well in all this stuff. So I guess we'll go through that real quick. American Beauty, if you haven't seen, is such a great dark comedy moving into our now, like, millennial, or now we're past it, but like, moving into the millennial generation. This was such a great movie of like, that twist of America. It was right in 1999, I think, and just like right during that change. And it was just, oh, American Beauty, if you haven't seen, I'd go watch it right away. It's all about Kevin Spacey, someone who's reached their midlife crisis, and then they just stop giving a fuck, and then they live great. They start smoking weed, they start working out. Like, it's, I fucking love that movie. And it's really well done. It's not just like, oh. Okay, so Kevin Spacey in that, and then Kevin Spacey in The Usual Suspects, the official best whodunit. I shouldn't even say that. That's the problem. Just watch Usual Suspects. Don't expect anything. People built up a lot of expectation for me, so when I watched it, I wasn't surprised at all because I was looking for the twist. There's not a twist. Then just don't go in with any expectations, but The Usual Suspects is great. Benicio Del Toro is in there with an you just can't tell what the fuck he's saying. He's just like, oh, blah, blah, blah. It's like, it's a weird movie. So Usual Suspects is great. And then also another one is, what's the LA Confidential? So this is really meta. It's like a 40s LA noir cop type movie. And I love that fucking time era. And it's got Russell Crowe as the muscle. It's got Kevin Spacey as kind of like the cop who's also an actor, and he's like too good for it. And then they also threw in Guy Pearce, and Guy Pearce is like the straight edge good cop. And like, it's such a good fucking dynamic. LA Confidential is probably my favorite cop movie. It's so great. I'd go watch that. And then, speaking of Guy Pearce was the guy who was in Memento. I didn't really hear much from him afterwards. He did this like modern sci-fi movie, which is really eh. But the one great thing that Guy Pearce I know was in was like fucking Memento. If you haven't seen this, this is one of Christopher Nolan's first movies. And I don't know if I've mentioned this, but Christopher Nolan's one of my favorite fucking directors ever. I think it's really funny when the camera dies, it's good because it resets a few things and I'm like, oh shit, I didn't drink water the entire last hour. So that was a great reminder for that. Also, it wasn't, wait, let me put another timer. Set timer for 22 minutes. It wasn't a thing where it timed out. It was actually the whole battery died. So I don't know where it cut me off. I really hope it got the tangent with Mr. Nobody in there, because I'm not doing it again, but seriously, watch Mr. Nobody. That's my favorite on this list. I say that about all of them though, because I fucking love so many movies. Okay. I really hope it didn't cut me off earlier. I'm gonna talk about Mr. Nobody a little bit more because I love it that much. Mr. Nobody is all about the entirety of life and the decisions that you make. And you know how when you think about that sometimes, like if I make a left turn or a right turn, what will happen? Will that change the entirety of the rest of my life? Will it have a butterfly effect? And that's what the whole movie's about. It's this kid who basically, he experiences that. Like every time he decides to go left, he also lived a right, he also lived a life where he went right. And basically like, yeah, and then he'll kind of like feel the other realities, and like I feel that in real life too. I feel like sometimes you can feel like the alternate realities within your same one, and like deja vu will feel like that. And deja vu is like you see something, you're like, maybe I saw that in a different life or something. And the live stream is about to kick me off on Instagram here. I'm gonna restart that. Okay. Wow, that was a. Normally not that many people join live. That's cool. All right, start live again. Okay, I'm back in this. Yeah, okay. So the next one I was gonna transition into is Drive. So, Ryan Gosling. Okay, where the fuck? I couldn't find it, but at least I have more. So Ryan Gosling was in this movie called Drive, and this was my first time I ever saw him in something. So I didn't have any like expectations or anything of him, and but I did think, I was like, oh, I don't know if this guy can act. Like, he might just be like a pretty boy. But I remember I saw it at Redbox, and it was like the coolest looking fucking thing at Redbox. No, wait. Yeah, wait, I did watch it on Redbox first, and then it was on Netflix later, and then I watched it like a million times when it was on Netflix. Okay, so I'm getting that right. But like, remember when people would Redbox stuff? Dude, okay, people probably still Redbox stuff. I haven't Redboxed something in a long time. Anyways, Highcrafts is up in here. What up? Also, Meredith, good to see y'all. Meredith showed up to the Denver meetup, and that was really fucking cool. And anyways, I'm just listing off some movies and shit that I think are dope to watch while smoking. And Drive is definitely on that list. So it's a weird combo. It's got Ryan Gosling and has Bryan Cranston as like his mentor kind of guy. And honestly, I don't have to say much about it because it's not about the plot or anything. It's 100% about the vibe. And I'm gonna play the song from it. It's totally copyright, but I don't give any fucks right now. So, where is it? Okay. Oh shit, maybe I should have remembered what the song was called first. Okay, Drive soundtrack. I'm hoping that Spotify does me good here. Oh, what up, Darian? Am I gonna post the list? I'll post the video, and then if I have time, I'll go through and find the list. Or if someone wants to write it down after they watch the video for me in the comments, that'd be great. That sounds ridiculous, but it's definitely gonna be in a video. I just realized this might take a while. I don't have time to play like all the songs. This is the song that goes, "And a real human being, and a real hero." Okay, I'm gonna skip to it. Yeah, I don't know if you guys heard this. This was a whole meme on 4chan. Okay, that's it. But also, I love this song. I fucking love this song. My first video on the WeedTube, I used this song because I loved it that fucking much. Oh, yeah. So I'm also recording video at once. I'm sorry if I'm not talking to these because I'm really into this video right now. Oh, wait. All right, that's enough of that. But one more. Listen to this fucking song. It's so cool. Yeah, Kavinsky. Okay, I'm done with that. But that's why you should watch Drive, because it's that vibe. And like, I don't know, I feel like everybody likes movies for different reasons, but for me, definitely in the past few years, like, I love the cinematography. I'm so into that. So when I watch Drive, oh fuck. So the first scene, if you watch this and you watch the car chase, one thing that you might not notice that I would love to point out is the entire scene is shot within the car. I know people are like, okay, who cares? Because action movies always try to do this thing. They're like, oh, drone shot, vroom, cut. Whoa, look at the outside of the tires. Look at how close they are to this car, and they just keep cutting. But in Drive, they're within the car. So, like, you're seeing the actual realistic point of view, like, looking out the windows and stuff. Like, it's not just cutting around. It's, oh, so fucking well done. And then the blocking and the framing of this movie is just next to none. And then this is what got me into color correcting. So I was always into cinematography, but this is the movie where I saw it and I was like, oh, fuck, that blue and teal, or not the blue and teal, the orange and teal, like, that got me. That was my full jush. When you watch it, you can see that all of the midtones are completely orange and all of the set dressing, and then all of the, you know, shadows are definitely very teal, and it's that Hollywood color, but they do it so well, and just like, oh, I love that movie so much. When he's just like driving the teal light on him, like, and that's why I bought my camera actually, so I could shoot at night. Like, literally, Drive has actually had a huge impact on me and how I make my videos actually. So, like, I didn't think about it for a while, but like, fucking Drive, dude. Love that movie. Okay. Also, that director made a couple other stuff. So, the director was Nicholas Winding Refn, and he also made Bronson. So this was like one of Tom Hardy's first movies, where he played this psychotic, deranged prisoner who liked to just beat the shit out of people. And anyways, Bronson was weird, but Drive was just like his perfect movie, and like, I relate to him because, I don't know, anyways, I'm getting too deep into it. Basically, his next movie, if people just want to watch the cinematography and get really high, Only God Forgives is really worth watching. Other than that, the plot and storyline of that movie don't really do much. But it's basically the same thing. It's like a remake. It's Ryan Gosling, but he's in Thailand this time. Yeah. So Only God Forgives, I loved because it was stoned alone colors the whole time. It was actually, oh fuck, did that movie influence my entire color scheme of this brand? I think that might have, well, part of it. Obviously, a lot of things are pink and blue. It's the whole Miami Vice color. I got a lot of it from Hotline Miami, but that movie did have a big impact. That was when I saw that, I was like, oh, that looks so fucking cool, because it would have him lit up completely neon pink, and then it would be like a dark blue background, and nobody does shit like that. The plot doesn't really do much, but like, the cinematography of that, oh. And that was when I first started smoking and watching movies, so I got baked off my ass. I don't remember a single thing, but it was perfect for that because I remember how cool it looked. Hit the blunt, bro. I mean, it's not really much in here, but I mean, I definitely will be. Okay. So what else other than that? Okay, I gotta dig deep here. A recent one I've liked was the Meyerowitz Stories. That's a long name, but if you search Dustin Hoffman, Ben Stiller, or Adam Sandler on Netflix, it's there. It's a Netflix original, and it's like, it's probably the best family movie I've seen. And not family movie, I mean by like watching with your family. I mean it's like about family dynamics, and it was really relatable because like, it was the person was in the hospital the whole time, the dad was, and like, my whole family watched it with my mom while she was in the hospital in Taiwan. So it was like, it was a whole thing. But Meyerowitz Stories is probably my favorite Adam Sandler movie. Again, Adam Sandler, like, I loved it, especially as a kid and everything. But like, you know, a lot of times I'm just like, Adam Sandler, like, I'm like, roll my eyes because, you know, like, I get his perspective. I think it's fucking cool that he just like makes movies and then he hangs out with his friends and then they basically just hang out on set and everything. But a lot of his movies are not that great. Meyerowitz Stories, he's fantastic in, like, oh, like, because Adam Sandler can actually act, you know. If you watch Punch Drunk Love, which is another thing, which is another movie I recommend, like, he's pretty good, but, like, anyways, so, yeah, all of the old Adam Sandler movies, I probably don't have to mention, they're pretty, classically known stoner movies, I love them, but, yeah, so, him in Punch Drunk Love, and him in Meyerowitz Stories was great, though, and, again, yeah, that's just a great movie about family dynamics. I highly recommend it to anybody. And then, speaking of Punch Drunk Love, though, the director of that, P.T. Anderson, has made some dank shit. So if you want to watch a movie that literally makes you feel like you're high without even getting high, watch Inherent Vice. He basically edits this movie to confuse you, and you're like, wait, what is the plot even? And like, you have all these questions. I hated it the first time I watched it. I was like, what the fuck is this? I was like, I don't even know like what I just watched. But now I love it because it's so just the vibe of like the whole like what? Like, the whole stoner vibe, and especially the 70s of it, because he's just, like, a detective, and he's trying to solve a case, but then he's getting really fucked up, and then, like, forgetting what he's doing, and he'll, like, look at his notes, and he'll be like, what does that mean? And he'll just get really high while he's writing notes, and just write, like, one word out of the whole, like, conversation, and, like, not for everybody. P.T. Anderson movies are honestly really weird, and I don't like them the first time I watched them, but I love them the second time. P.T. Anderson, though, yeah, he's great. He made a cult movie. That's probably not a good stoner movie. Honestly, no. Not even gonna talk about that one. It is a good movie in general, though. But P.T. Anderson made Boogie Nights, and I love Boogie Nights. So if I haven't mentioned also, 70s is my shit. I fucking love 70s themed movies, the whole vibe of it, everything. So Boogie Nights is, it might be a little more 80s, but, like, you know, kind of around that era. Mark Wahlberg has a huge dick in this movie. I'm not even kidding. He's, like, a kid, and then he's like, I can become a porn star, and then he does, and it's wild. It has, who else is in that one? It's got Don Cheadle in it. Weird choice. And then it's, I mean, that's probably all I have to say for it. Porn stars, Don Cheadle, 70s. If that sounds lit to you, watch Boogie Nights, because that's a great movie. And then, what, did Pete Anderson do anything else? He made Let There Be Blood. I don't know if everybody will like that. It's a very slow burn movie, but if you're into, like, a really nice drama that's gonna take a long time, but it's a huge payoff at the end, watch There Will Be Blood. That's a great fucking one. Big Lebowski, again, you know, it's probably well known, but, like, Big Lebowski, you gotta fucking check it out if you wanna watch some stoner movies. So classic. Yeah, okay. There's gotta be some more. I know there was somewhere, I was just like, before I started smoking, I would watch a movie, and I'd be like, oh, when I start smoking, this movie's gonna be insane. Like, there's some movies that are, like, that perfect for smoking. Revolver. So Revolver is directed by Guy Ritchie. And Guy Ritchie made the new Sherlock Holmes movies with Robert Downey Jr., but he was lit, like, back in the day, in the 90s and early 2000s. He made Snatch. If you don't know this movie, too, fucking watch Snatch. Brad Pitt as a really fast-talking pikey. Basically, like, an Irish trailer park white trash person. But, like, Jason Statham is in it, and he's, like, a really shitty, like, English kind of, you know, crime person. Anyways, watch Snatch. It's just, it's so good. It's just probably my favorite British movie. It's got, like, all of the elements of a comedy, and it's got all the elements of a great heist plot, and then it also has all of the separate timelines, and that's my favorite shit, when all the separate timelines are doing different things and having different discoveries. So Snatch is a great one. Like I said, it's got that pretty big cast, and it's hilarious, but also the year, I think, it was like 3 years after that, or like the year after that, right after Snatch, came out this movie called Revolver, and it has a huge cast, but I haven't heard anyone in real life ever talk about this movie. It's probably my favorite fucking movie, and the funny thing was, back then, my brother's about 6 years older than me, so I would watch all these movies with my brother, because I'm like, oh, dude, you gotta watch this movie, the fucking editing I've heard is insane, and he's like, oh, okay, sure, because he'd be like my age, and he'd be like, okay, and then he'd like go to the bathroom, probably smoke like a huge blunt, and he'd be like, all right, I'm ready to watch this movie, but I would show him like the trippiest shit, and I just remember him being like, what the fuck, and like, it was so dope, and you know, honestly, that makes me so happy that I was always like, because right now, I feel like I don't have that ability. As a kid, I was insane with movies. I knew every fucking one. I was like, I know exactly what I want to watch. All this stuff. I had lists. So, like, I would show him all these crazy, trippy-ass stuff while he's really high. And now I went back and watched it baked. And it's insane. It's this entire movie that's disguised as a casino-type plotline. Like, an action, you know, macho, like, gambling kind of thing. Where they also, like, you know, have guns and stuff. And it's Jason Statham, there's Ray Liotta, and for some reason, Andre 3000, who's perfect in this movie. So it's got this weird cast, and when you're watching it, the whole time it's disguised as, you know, like what I just said, you're looking for this action or whatever. But in the way end, the actual entire movie was about the ego and how the enemy was the ego the whole time, and that he didn't actually have an antagonist in the movie. It was just like his own ego. And then the movie ends, and then there's like Deepak Chopra and shit, and they're like talking about it and like for the movie, and it's like, Revolver, fucking, it's so good. It might take a couple times to get it because I didn't notice it at all. You care about the, oh, you notice I care about the editing side of things. Yeah, I mean, like, editing, to me, movies is like editing and cinematography, and actually it's everything, because that's what I love the most. And then as I'm watching it, I appreciate everything else so much more. Like, sound design is not something that I can do. I suck at sound design. Like, I try, but like that's not my suit. You know, I love the visuals. I can do a mean visual. I can do a mean cut. But when it comes to the sound, you know, I'm pretty tone deaf. And that's why I enjoy movies. It's like, I just hear all the separate mixing. I'm like, oh, they put in so much fucking work with this, with all of the Foley. You guys don't even know, like in movies, when people are walking down hallways, they have an entire studio with all of these different materials and really nice microphones. And they'll have someone walk on a specific type of material to the beat of the movie, and they'll like watch the screen of the movie and walk to it. And every single movie is scored like this. It's called Foley, and they're Foley artists, and then they record all this Foley, which is the audio for the movies. And it's like, yeah, just when you edit, like, you really appreciate it so much more, because when you film someone walking down a hallway, there is nothing. It's like a lot of background noise, a bunch of shit. But like when you watch a movie, you really appreciate the crisp, like, of the footsteps, like, I have some sound effects here. It's like, if you just hear this, you'll see that, like, just a little bit of audio. This is, like, one file on my laptop. See how much of a difference that makes? And you layer all of these. You layer, like, a billion sounds. Here's some footsteps. Oh, here's what I use for New York. I love this file of footsteps. This is probably my favorite footstep file I have. Everyone left the Periscope. They're like, what the fuck is this? Anyways, yeah, but I hope you enjoyed this recommendation of movies. I'm gonna load up another bowl here and then kind of head out. I could talk about this for days and days, but honestly, I probably just threw so many out that it's like a lot. But I recommend like going through, picking out like a couple, because I really, really want people to watch this shit. Like, I'm serious. Like, the movies, like, these are so amazing. I can't explain them. And that's the cool thing. It's like, I don't have to, like, explain a whole concept of shit. I can just say, watch this movie. And then you guys will be like, oh, I totally get it. You know? And, like, I don't know. When I talked about Perfect Blue, I didn't think about it much. But I was in Taiwan. I just watched Perfect Blue. And I did a whole thing talking about it. And people were like, oh, shit. And, like, I got so many comments of people that actually went out and watched it. And it's, you know, it's a Japanese movie that you have to have subtitles for. It's anime. So I didn't expect, like, anyone to watch it. And that literally made me so happy that all those people watched it. So I hope you guys enjoy these. Also, another thing I'm going to throw out there is the Studio Ghibli movies. So Spirited Away, Totoro, and those are my two top picks for the Studio Ghibli movies. Also, Princess Mononoke, please, oh my god, if you don't watch the movies in your life, like, I don't know, you did your life wrong. You gotta watch the Studio Ghibli movies. They were basically like my Pixar movies, because as a kid, my mom had the whole sleeve, the collector's edition, and not the collector's edition, it was more like the pirated edition that she bought in the alleyway of every single movie that was made by Studio Ghibli, and she had all the DVDs in this disc, and it was actually like a 100. She would unzip the thing, and it had all the little sleeves, so I've watched like all the Studio Ghibli movies, and that was my childhood, so I definitely recommend that. You guys gotta fucking watch those. Fuck, dude. Yeah, and then that's the thing, like, that's coming back in style, too. Like, Spirited Away, all this stuff, I'm seeing all the time in pop culture now, so it's definitely coming back, and I'm really appreciative of that, because it's what I grew up on, and I thought it was really fucking cool. Take a rip here. I also recommend The Fall. So this is a movie that Aaron showed to me. It's a David Fincher movie, and that's all I gotta say about it. Most insane match cuts I've ever seen. Cinematography is ridiculous. All right. Oh my God. Is there any last minute ones I want to say? I love so many movies, guys. You don't even know. What else is a great stoner movie? Oh, what up, Kush Cargo is up in here. All right. I feel like I have to come up with like one Holy Grail one, and then I'll have to bounce out of here. Let me start by thinking of directors that I haven't mentioned. Okay, wait. No, I can't mention like a 40s French movie. Nobody's gonna watch that. Okay, Super. You know, Super's a good movie. So everybody knows Guardians of the Galaxy now, but what people didn't know was like the director, James Gunn, nobody really heard of him before that, and the movie I watched by him was made in 2009 with a $2 million budget. If you guys don't know, $2 million is like nothing for a movie. So it's amazing that he pulled that off. But he had Kevin Bacon in there. He had Dwight from The Office. I knew his name. Rainn Wilson. Ellen Page, which is why I watched it. And yeah, it's a pretty cool lineup right there. And it's almost like Kick-Ass. Also, Kick-Ass is a great movie. I would recommend that, especially like the teenage kind of crowd. But Super is like if someone was really fed up with the world and they're like, you know what, I want to become a fucking superhero. What would actually happen? It's pretty realistic. And I loved that movie. And the thing was like, there's a whole interesting thing there. Like James Gunn was married to Jenna Fischer, I think, who was Pam from The Office, and then so like it was a whole interesting thing there, and like I don't know, I was so into that movie. I bought the whole collector set. I watched all the behind the scenes and everything. I have to hop out of here now, actually. But thank you so much for watching this. I hope you have a great day. Okay, bye. Super was a horrible movie. Oh, come on, man. I mean, okay, honestly, I probably only liked it because, like, I was so into the whole indie thing, and, like, it's not that great of a movie, but I still love Super, dude. Like, I don't know. I damn. All right. Anyways, so thank you so much for watching this on the WeedTube. I will also post this onto my YouTube channel, Stones Tim. I'm Stones Tim on Twitter, Rise, and Instagram. And yeah, I mean, thank you so much for watching this. I hope you enjoyed it. I want to post more stuff out there. Let me know if you like this and you want to see more of this uncut type of shit. Bye.